Hello, everyone, and welcome to today's lecture video. We have an exciting session ahead where we'll delve into the world of chronic illnesses, focusing on one particular class of chronic illness, cardiovascular disease. These conditions affect millions around the world, and understanding them is not just about biology or medicine. As we'll see, psychology plays an important role too. Let's start with the differences between acute and chronic illnesses. Acute illnesses are usually severe and sudden in onset. Think of them as the medical world's equivalent to a sprint. They come on quickly, cause significant symptoms, and then after treatment, they usually resolve in a relatively short amount of time. Take, for instance, a broken bone or the flu. You feel the impact immediately, it requires immediate attention, but with proper treatment, you recover fully. On the other hand, chronic illnesses are more like a marathon. Chronic illnesses, by definition, are conditions that stick around for a year or more and often require ongoing medical treatment. They can range from mild to life-threatening and may accompany us throughout our life. They're also more common as we age. In fact, did you know that over the age of 65, 85% of US adults have at least one chronic illness? But remember, these conditions are just one part of our overall health story. A large part of chronic conditions are influenced by lifestyle factors. It's a complex mix of psychological, physiological, and sociocultural elements that determine our risks, the course of illness, and our ability to cope. For instance, cancer, we explored in the previous video, is one such illness. In this video, we'll go a step further and explore cardiovascular diseases. Now, again, let's compare the two categories. Again, the primary difference lies in the duration and the speed of onset. Acute illnesses come on rapidly and last a short amount of time, while chronic illnesses develop slowly and persist over a long period, often a lifetime. But the differences go beyond duration. The treatment approach is also different. For acute illnesses, treatment is usually focused on immediate relief and eradication of the condition. For chronic illnesses, treatment usually aims at managing the condition, relieving symptoms, and slowing progression. Why is it important to understand this difference? Because it impacts how we approach healthcare. If you're dealing with an acute illness, the focus is on getting immediate medical attention and treatment. However, for chronic illnesses, it's about long-term management, which includes lifestyle modifications, regular medical checkups, and often ongoing medication. Because chronic illnesses become part of our lives when we're diagnosed, the biopsychosocial model will apply to other outcomes too. And both internal and external factors can make coping easier or harder. Let's first talk about health disparities in chronic illness. Our bodies may all work in similar ways, but our experiences with chronic illness can vary greatly depending on our sex, ethnicity, and social conditions. For instance, chronic kidney disease sees a higher rate among Black Americans, a significant health disparity. And higher adverse health disparities are also seen among Latinos for conditions like childhood obesity, adult diabetes, and advanced cancers. Understanding these disparities can help us work toward a more equitable healthcare system. When it comes to chronic illness, there's a whole emotional side to the story. A diagnosis can bring a flood of emotions: grief, guilt, loneliness, and even depression or anxiety. And it can feel like a loss of identity, self-esteem, and independence. But here's the thing, it's okay to feel these emotions. It really is, I promise. They're a natural part of the journey. And the trajectory of chronic illness varies for everyone. Some may experience stress and anxiety, while others may find post-traumatic growth, where the experience of illness brings about positive changes in a person's life. And last but not least, let's talk about coping with chronic illness. It can bring significant changes to our lives. But remember, you're stronger than you think. Active, problem-focused strategies can help us cope more effectively, develop a sense of self-efficacy, and live a full and meaningful life. So let's pivot to a deeper look into the most common chronic illness that faces all Americans and many other cultures in the world, cardiovascular disease, or CVD. The heart, a vital organ with four chambers, works tirelessly to pump blood throughout our bodies. But sometimes things can go wrong, leading to CVDs. These include conditions like coronary heart disease, okay, and stroke. And they're the leading causes of death, not just in the United States, but in most developed countries. One of the main culprits behind CVD is atherosclerosis, or coronary heart disease, where fatty deposits and plaques narrow the coronary arteries. These arteries supply the heart with blood, because one of nature's greatest ironies is that the blood that flows through the heart doesn't actually nourish the heart with anything. The blood must go outside of the heart to nourish the heart with oxygen and nutrients, a very important distinction. If left unchecked, this coronary heart disease can lead to angina pectoris, which is pain in the chest, myocardial infarction, which is my favorite medical term, stands for a heart attack, or potentially stroke, which is a cerebrovascular disorder that can cause death or limit to brain function due to brain death, which resulted from a lack of oxygen from a dissolved and dislodged clot. Thankfully, medical advancements have given ways to manage this condition, such as controlling blood pressure and cholesterol levels, and even techniques like transplanting muscle-derived embryonic stem cells into damaged parts of the heart. Now, various studies have helped identify risks for CVD. These include the Framingham Heart Study, which began in 1948, the Nurses' Health Study, which was established in 1976, and then more recently, the Interheart Study, which was established and is ongoing since 2004. Some factors are considered uncontrollable, like family history, age, gender, and ethnicity. But other risk factors are considered controllable, like hypertension or high blood pressure, obesity, elevated serum cholesterol. You get this from mostly from the foods that you eat, metabolic syndrome, which comes about through a sedentary lifestyle, and of course, smoking cigarettes or tobacco products. And then there's psychological aspects, including type A behavior pattern, which is characterized by competitive, hurried, and hostile behaviors and attitudes. And today, it's very interesting. Many researchers are focusing on these aspects of type A personality, such as hostility and anger, and its impact on your heart. And so this is where psychology enters our discussion. Hostile people may be at greater risk of CVD because they have more stressful lives and lower social support. Frequent episodes of anger might damage the coronary arteries. But there's good news too. Positive psychological well-being, which we've talked about in previous videos, like emotional vitality or optimism, is associated with cardiovascular health. We can reduce the risk of CVD by making these lifestyle modifications. These are the controllable risk factors. Things like reducing hypertension, regulating our body weight, improving our diets to reduce that serum cholesterol, and increasing the amount of exercise, like we said in a previous video. Comprehensive interventions that combine stress management, aerobic exercise, and low-fat diets can even reverse CVD development in your body. And let's not forget about the power of psychology, gaining control over environmental triggers for angry reactions and modifying negative outcomes are also effective. And so that brings us to the end of today's lecture. We explored how chronic illnesses like cardiovascular diseases are not just biological conditions, but how they intertwine with our lifestyle, emotions, and behaviors. Remember, knowledge is power, and understanding these conditions can be the first step toward prevention and better management. Thank you for joining me, and good luck as you get older.